In the beginning, it was only one program. Just a sequence of CPU instructions. No other programs, no operating system, nothing exists yet. Only a single CPU executing instructions one by one. The second program comes up. Now we want to execute both of them with a single CPU. We want to make the impression of simultaneous execution. We want to switch between these guys every 10 milliseconds. We need special hardware support for that. This is the timer. The timer sends the electric signal to the CPU each 10 milliseconds. When it happens, we want to make the CPU switch between our programs. The CPU doesn't have some magic instruction to do that, but it can do one trick. When the signal from the timer comes, the CPU immediately stops the execution and jumps to a very special piece of code. This piece of code is the very beginning of our operating system. In the kernel code, we want to switch the execution to the process 1. What do we need for that? Essentially, the execution of any code is operations with memory and operations with registers. Let's keep aside all the memory mechanisms. So, to switch between the processes, we need to switch the state of the registers. While the process 2 was executing, the CPU had some numbers into its registers. When the signal from the timer comes, the CPU forces the program counter to point to the first instruction of the kernel code. All the other registers are untouched and still contain values of the process 2. The first goal of the kernel code would be to save current values of the registers. We are ready to switch to the process 1. We already have its saved registers values. We saved it before, when the timer signal came the last time. Now we can restore them and continue the execution of the process 1. What we've done is named process scheduling. The timer is not the only hardware sending signals to the CPU. By the way, such signals are called interrupts. Keyboard, mouse, network card, there are a lot of different ones, but the idea is the same. Receive the interrupt, jump to the kernel code, save current registers, handle the interrupt, find the next task to run, restore its registers, and jump back to the execution. Now let's pretend that this process is a display manager. It wants to know the mouse position to draw it on the display. How to ask the kernel about it? First, the kernel has some sort of mouse subsystem. When we move the mouse, the interrupt from it comes to the CPU. The kernel handles the interrupt. It will call a function from the mouse subsystem to let it know that the mouse position has changed. When the display manager wants to ask the kernel about mouse position, it should call some kernel function like getMousePosition. Just like a normal function, with a regular jump or branch instruction. This is a usual thing for small operating systems. But if any program can access kernel functions in memory, any mistake in this program can crash the whole computer, or even worse, do something intentionally bad. We don't want that. In big systems like Linux or even Windows, we have some protection about that. We introduce a privileged execution mode. Now all the code and memory are divided into kernel space and user space, and the CPU has two execution modes, normal and privileged. While in privileged mode, the CPU can access everything, both in kernel space and user space, but while in normal mode, only user space is allowed. If the CPU, while in user mode, tries to do something privileged, it will cause the CPU exception. CPU exception is something very much like interrupt, but it triggered not by external hardware, but by executed instruction. It could be something like bad memory access, division by zero, or just a privilege violation. In case of exception, the CPU jumps to the special piece of code, exactly the same way as for the interrupt. So, back to mouse position. We want to ask the kernel about it, but with privileged kernel, we can't just call a function because it will cause the exception. To ask the kernel about something, we have a special instruction, system call. And guess what? It works almost like an interrupt or exception. We put arguments to registers, execute system call instruction. The CPU jumps to a special piece of code and at the same time switches its execution mode to privileged. All the other stuff is almost the same. save the registers, handle a system call, maybe reschedule, restore registers, and jump back to the user space program. This return to user space instruction does jump to user space code and at the same time changes the CPU execution mode back to normal. As a summary, the kernel code is executed only when the interrupt arrives or CPU exception happens, and when the user program invokes a system call. There is no other kernel entry point, only those three. When any of those happens, the CPU switches the execution mode to privileged. And all these cases are handled sort of similar. Save the current execution context, handle interrupt system call or exception, maybe reschedule, restore the context, and jump back to the user space.